Okay, let's start. Remember at the beginning of the semester we said that we are studying object-oriented programming languages in this course. And as example, object-oriented programming languages, we are gonna see both C++ and Java. So far, we have been covering C++. From time to time, we try to talk a little bit about Java, but not much. But today, we will start discussing this programming language, Java. Let's look at the kind of very short history of Java. Beginning of 1990s, it was developed for intelligent consumer electronic devices, like the refrigerators. They said that everything is becoming computers. Okay, they are all becoming computers. Refrigerators, ovens, washing machines, dishwashers, they are all becoming computers. So what kind of programs are going to run on these computers? How are we going to program those? That was the idea under the main idea of the Java. They say that let's come up with a programming language that can be used, whose code can be used on many, many devices. That was the original idea, but later it turned out that Java is very useful for creating web pages with dynamic content. That's what they are doing. Nowadays, they use Java for large-scale enterprise applications. Like in Turkey, many very large banks, very large banks, they do their own development for their enterprise applications, Java. It is used in World Wide Web server functionality. And maybe nowadays, the most common application for Java programming language is the Android programming. As you know, the most of the Android programming is done in Java. So it is no surprise that Java is the number one language for the last maybe 10 years, right? I showed you the graph. C and C++, they come second, third, maybe fourth. Python is making its way to the top nowadays. So Java is important, but it is a very popular language. We need to know it. Second, it's a very nice example of an object-oriented programming language. That's why we are gonna look at Java. Let's start from the beginning, a typical Java development environment. It's a regular language in a way. In some other ways, it is a little bit different from C, C, and C++. Of course, we write our programs using some kind of an editor, like a Pico or VI or whatever your favorite notepad or whatever your favorite editor is. Then we compile our programs. After that, the things change a little bit. Once you compile and link your program, C++ programs are ready to run on the target environment, like the operating system and the hardware. Java programs are a little bit different. You compile your programs into bytecodes. Okay? Bytecodes are not object codes. Okay? They are not like linkable object codes of C or C++ compilers. They are executable codes that can be executed by a virtual machine. Java defines a software application called Java Virtual Machine, JVM. Okay? It's a software, okay? It's run like a software. Whatever you compile into bytecode has to be run using the software. Okay? Using the software. Maybe I should give you this example. Okay? Let's say I have my test.cpp. Test.cpp, one of the main things that C and C++ said at the beginning is C and C++ are portable. What do I mean by portable? If you have the compiler on a Unix system or a Windows system, on a Macintosh OS system, Apple system, doesn't matter. If you have the compiler, you compile the same code on different environments and you execute them. But you cannot do this. I compiled my test.cpp to test.o, then I linked it to get the test.exe, executable test program. I can run this on my system, my hardware CPU on top of it. I have my operating system Linux. I have my executable program. I can compile it on this one and run it on this one. But I cannot take this executable on a Windows system that runs on different hardware and run it. It is not possible. How do you take this test program to this environment? You need to take this test.cpp and you need to compile it with the Visual Studio or whatever compiler is available for the Windows environment for that CPU. Java is a little bit different. Java says that take the Java compiler. This is the Java compiler. Okay. Test.java is a Java program. You compile it. You get this bytecode. It is called test.class. It's the compiled code. Okay. It's an object code. It is called a bytecode that corresponds to our object codes in C and C++. Okay, it's called bytecode and it is named as dot class file. Okay, I compiled it on this Windows environment. I get this test.class. I can run this on top of this Java virtual machine in this Windows environment, or I can take that test.class, I can run the same compiled code on this environment where my operating system is Unix, maybe my hardware is different. So they call this compile once, run everywhere. Okay, you compile it once and it runs everywhere. As long as you have the Java virtual machine available for that environment, you are fine. Okay, that was the reason they thought that once I write my program for the refrigerator, it's going to run on all kinds of refrigerators as long as Java virtual machine is available for that refrigerator. Okay? It doesn't matter if it is running on a embedded Linux or embedded Windows or regular Windows or some kind of a new operating system. As long as that environment provides the Java virtual machine, I should be fine. That was the idea at the beginning in the 1990s. And later they realized that this is perfect fit for web pages. Why? Because if I am the web server, okay, I am serving my clients. Doesn't matter my clients are Android clients or Windows clients or OS X clients, it doesn't matter. The programs they am offering to them will run as long as Java Virtual Machine is available on those environments, okay? So in 1990s, this was a big news. You are providing your own programs on your web page and everybody can run them because Java is portable at this level. Compile once and run everywhere. Okay, so that was the idea. But later it turned out that this is a dangerous idea, very big security problems, because if you are free to run your software on any kind of environment, that means that if you have some bad intentions, you can hurt lots of people. That's why people are not using this feature of Java anymore. I mean, you are not allowed to download your code. If you are the web server, you are not allowed to upload your code to your client. Most of the web browser disabled this option, but still we are using this structure in our program. So this is what we're going to do. There are two things. One is the Java compiler. This is the name of the Java compiler, like GCC or G++. We will compile our code into class files, bytecodes. Then we are going to use this Java virtual machine, its name is Java, okay, to run our programs. Our programs are not executable on the hardware and the operating system directly. They are executable by this program, okay? There is another program. It is running our compiled Java code, okay? And this program is available for most environments that we know, and it is provided by the developer of the Java programming language. At the beginning, it used to be Sun Corporation. Now Sun Corporation is bankrupt. Nowadays it is Oracle. Oracle and Java Consortium, they provide these kind of virtual machines to any kind of environment. And your applications are okay to run for most of the environments that you like. Okay. So far, that's the introduction. Any questions so far? I mean, as C programmers and C++ programmers, the first thing whenever I mention about this to a C programmer, the first thing they say that means that at the same time there are two things are running in my memory, right? One is the Java virtual machine, the other one is my code. So that means that I need to share the CPU with some other program, which means inefficiency. The answer is yes. Yeah. Java, from the beginning, is designed that way. Efficiency is, of course, important, but it is not as important as this kind of portability. Because in 1990s, I mean, remember, C is developed during 70s. During those days, even a single clock cycle was important. Even a single byte was important. So you need to write optimized code. And when we come to 1980s, okay, when we come to 1980s, again, the one of the concerns of C++ was, okay, let's be object-oriented, but let's be efficient too. But when the time come to 1990s, mid-1990s, CPUs were okay. We had enough large enough memory amounts. Now they say that let's look at this object-oriented programming more carefully. Maybe we could be a little bit inefficient, but let's do it right. So Java was the answer and became so popular. Nowadays, for the last 10 years maybe, it is the most popular language that we know. Okay, any questions? Let me have one or two questions at this point. I don't want to start with very quiet crowd. Yes?
How does that, this kind of portability introduces many security problems like health and security problems?
Well, I mean, this is your program, this is your program, this is your hardware, this is your hardware. You write your own program, everything is fine. But if you are a web server, okay, if you are a client to a web server, you are downloading compiled code from that web server, that's a very big security problem because you don't know what kind of program it is downloading, right? I mean, that program might be trying to format your hard drive, or that program might be installing some kind of a spy program to your system, and this happened. I mean, even if it happens once in a million time, okay, that's a very big security problem. That's why they disabled this feature for most of the Java-based web servers. Instead, they are using JavaScript-type code. JavaScript has nothing to do with Java. It is a less capable, I wouldn't call it a language, but the system, and they are very careful about those security issues. Yes?
Can you see, and possibly C++, we can reach hardware in a very detailed manner. Can we do this in Java?
No. This is as simple as that, yes. No, the answer is definitely no. There is no, remember in C++, we have the left shift, right shift operators to manipulate the bits. There are no bits in Java. Okay. No. Java, in Java you don't have bit. You don't have this term bit in Java. No. Okay. We are not going to talk about much about, well, I mean, if you look at a Java programming book, they don't talk much about the memory, physical memory especially, because everything runs on a virtual machine. You don't talk about physical memory. Okay, everything is virtual. It doesn't matter if you are running on a. That's a good point. I was going to talk about it later, but remember what we said about C. We said that how many bytes is a double? 4 bytes, four bytes, and sometimes it's 8 bytes. Sometimes we don't know if it's a 64-bit processor and operating system. But what is the answer? Depends on the operating system. Depends on the CPU, etc. In Java, doubles are 4 bytes. It's guaranteed. Is it 4 bytes, hocam? Doubles?
No, 8 bytes.
8 bytes. Okay. But it is known. It is fixed. How could this happen? How could this happen? I mean, how come C cannot make this guarantee, but Java can do it? Because Java works on a virtual machine. Virtual machine is software, okay? In software, you can do anything you like, okay?
You can do the same thing in C as well if you put it in the specification.
all the compilers support the same thing probably.
Yeah, but they don't want to do that. Why not? Because it becomes inefficient. In fact, remember in C++, we had types that guarantees the byte size, right? But we don't suggest using them because they are inefficient. If the structure of the environment, the CPU is not compatible with that double size, then your program will be slow. For Java, this is not important. The important thing is that all the doubles are 8 bytes, all the integers are 4 bytes, all the characters are 1 byte. This is guaranteed, okay? This is guaranteed. And you don't care if the underlying hardware is supporting 4 byte doubles or 8 byte doubles. Java says that I will handle it. It might cost you a little bit CPU time, but it will be okay. So that's one reason. I mean, related to your question, how are we gonna know what the bits are doing, or how are we gonna know how the memory is performing? We will not talk about that much, and Java people don't talk about that much. Yes.
About this, the JVM, the Java programs can be a lot faster since they just-in-time compilation feature. Like when a program is running, Java Virtual Machine can generate the machine code directly to execute the code faster.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's one of the things that when they face with this kind of criticism, that's what Java people say. But the statistics says that C programs are 50% faster than C++ programs, and C++ programs are 50% faster than Java programs. So C is usually 2 times faster than Java programs. Of course, you can do some optimization, and we will talk about the optimizations. Sometimes for some specific cases, okay, some program types, Java programs could be as fast as C programs. But if you are a very careful C programmer, you won't be any slower than Java, and most of the time you will be much faster than Java. Okay? That doesn't mean that your program will be faster. That doesn't mean that your programming will be faster. Okay? Usually in Java, it is much easier, it is much faster, more convenient to come up to speed on a specific problem. Start from the problem because the environment is supports lots of libraries, and object orientation makes our code reusability very, very convenient. And most of the time, you don't need very, very experienced. I mean, C is not a programming language for kids, okay? It's a serious programming language. And if you are a good C programmers, and we are trying to educate you that way, you will write serious, good, fast, efficient C programs. But not everybody can have that kind of education, okay? So most of the time, it is important to have something developed in a very, very fast way, and Java is more suitable for that kind of application, okay? So that doesn't mean that Java is useless, Java is not usable for those kind of applications. Not everybody, especially enterprise applications, not everybody needs to access the bits, okay? They don't have to be very, very, very efficient, okay? What did I say? Java programs are 2 times faster than Java. C programs are 2 times faster than Java programs. You know the rule, right? Every 18 months, the computers get 2 times faster. So that's like a 2 years of difference. Wait 2 years, and your Java program will be as fast as C programs. And that's why nowadays they started writing embedded code using Java. Even though they don't have access to bits, okay? They have good enough libraries to support embedded programming in Java. Okay, good. Okay, let's continue. This is what we are gonna have. We are gonna edit our Java program, compile it, okay? When we compile it, it compiles into bytecode, okay? Then we load our bytecode into memory, and we verify it, okay? This loader and verifier is built inside our Java Virtual Machine. Why do I verify it? Because bytecode verifier confirms all kinds of security issues and everything, okay? We didn't have this before. And then Java Virtual Machine says that I am going to execute this one. As our friend indicated there, during the Java Virtual Machine, Java Virtual Machine is like an interpreter. It says that I am reading this line and I'm executing it, reading it and executing it. Sometimes it takes shortcuts. It says that I will compile this part of code into native CPU language, assembly code or machine code. I will run it like a C code, okay? It will do it, but again, it's an overhead. So with that one, it could be as fast as C code, but it will not be faster than a carefully written C code. Good. Okay, let's look at our first example, a Java program, very, very simple program. Our name of the file is welcome1.java. Okay, welcome1.java. And I have only 13 lines of code. Inside this program, I should have a class named welcome1. Okay, your class name should be same as the file name. At least one class should be public, and we'll talk about this public later. We never had this before, a public class before, other than the inner classes. A public class welcome1, okay, name is same as the file name. This is the class definition. It starts from here and ends here. Notice that I don't have this semicolon at the end of the class definition. This is one of the biggest differences between C and C++. I mean, it is not a single syntax difference. The missing semicolon tells you a lot about the main logic and C++ and Java. And we will talk about why we don't need that semicolon in there. Maybe I should ask you that. Why do we a C++ code? Remember the class that I like most? What was the class? Class A, this one, right? Why do we have this semicolon here in C++? What? Why don't they have the same thing for Java? Yes. To prevent what? Yeah. After that, maybe I could say integer A, right? This is a global integer, and this is a class definition. Remember, in C++, I could say A1, A2. What does A1? What is the type of A1? A, right? A2. In Java, this is not possible. In Java, you can't do that. Why not? I will tell you, okay? In Java, this is not possible, and on purpose, they prevented this so that they could do something smart, okay? So always remember this one, different. Program class definition is here. And here is our main method. In Java, we don't call them functions, we call them methods. We don't call them data members, we call them fields, okay? Methods and fields, okay? So if your program is going to be a runnable, executable program, it has to have one main method defined inside this public class whose name is same as the file name, welcome1, okay? So as you may have guessed, these are the command line arguments. And we had the same thing with the C, right? What did the C accept? It accepted a pointer of character pointers. Right? That was the first argument. What was the second argument? Number of the arguments, right? Because in C, whenever you pass an array to a function, you need to provide the number of parameters too. And this is how you pass the arrays to a method in Java. Either this way or this way. I like this way much better. Okay? You are saying that the type of args is a string array. Okay? It's a string array. That's one thing, but the number of elements inside this array is missing. Where is it? Well, this string is a smart class. It contains the number of, it's like a vector. Think about this one. I mean, this array is like a vector. So the vector, as like the vector knows the number of elements in it, this array knows the number of elements in it too. So you don't need to pass the number of elements to a method. Okay. So it has a single line of code. It looks like it is printing something to the screen. System.out.println. Okay. Println is a method of this object. Okay. And out is like our cout. Remember inside for C, C++ program, cout was a global object and we didn't like it. In Java, you don't have any global objects. You don't have any global methods, global functions. Everything has to belong to the classes. That's why our main method belongs to this public class. And this output object belongs to this structure that we talk about later. Think about this like a class, and out is a static object inside that class. Okay, it's a static object. That's why I can access it directly. In Java, we don't have a binary scope resolution operator. All we have is the dot operator. Okay, inside this class, there is an object, and inside that object, there is this println function. I am calling that println function, the println method. And the task of the println method is to print this string out to the screen. When I compile this and run this, I will get this line from the screen. I am not sure if I have the... Do I have it available somewhere? CPP test. Do I have my Java program in there? No, maybe I can write one. Do you remember what did I use to write programs? No. What did I use? I forgot. What? Node plus plus is not available in here. Maybe I should use VI? Use VI? Yeah, I have VI. Good. I have VI and my English keyboard is available. What was the name of the... Okay, welcome. Welcome.cp... Oh, Java. Okay, it's Java now. And public class... It has to be named welcome, and I need to switch to English keyboard. Okay. And public void main. String my arguments, okay, and this system dot out dot print line okay, welcome, that's it. And don't forget my semicolon there. I guess, am I missing anything? Is it the same? Yeah. Why, welcome and, yeah, okay. So, I hope I have the Java compiler installed. Okay, so let's see if I have the Java compiler. It looks like... No. What am I going to do? It says that install this one. Should I install it now? Connect. Okay, I'm showing you how to install a Java. Okay. Am I connected now? Okay. JDK means Java Development Kit. I don't remember my... Was this the... Okay.
You didn't tell it loud, right?
Well, I mean, I typed something. I don't remember what I typed, but it was correct. So if I don't... Oh, it says 7 minutes. Anyway, I was going to do this. How do I get another? Okay, so this is my Java program. I was going to do Java compiler, welcome Java. Okay. After that, it was going to compile my code. And it was going to produce, it is supposed to produce a java.class file. Then I was going to type Java and welcome. And when I do this, it is going to give me welcome on my screen. Let's see if the other one is doing, where is my other? Okay, I think it will be ready in 5 minutes, and maybe we can after the break maybe I'll show you that one. Okay, so this is what I am going to do. I have it in here. No. Java compiler welcome1.java. Okay, it will produce welcome1.class, and I will run it that way. Java welcome1. Yes. No, that's the whole point. Yeah, I mean, this is compiled code level compatibility. As long as you have this Java test.class, welcome.class, you can take that class file to any place that you like, as long as you have the Java virtual machine available. It doesn't matter if it is on this cell phone, on this watch, or on that computer, on a web server, on your refrigerator. Doesn't matter. It should work. Well, I mean, that's what they argue. Yeah. That's what they argue. But usually C people, those kind of people, they don't call it compile once, run everywhere. I mean, this is a real world. Real world is not the perfect world. They call it compile once, debug everywhere. Because things have... I mean, if you have some kind of a windowing application, you know that the types of the windows in Windows operating system is different. The shape is different, right? The buttons are at different places. And the window structure is different on Unix environment, and window structure is different on the Apple environment, right? So at least your looks will be different, right? So you don't get perfect level compatibility with this kind of approach. But that's the idea. Most of the time, most of the work will be okay. Okay, good. So once I compile my program and it works. So good. Yes.
At least we have at least one class in every course.
Every file, you mean? Every file should have at least one class, a public class whose name should be same as the file name. Okay.
Possible to have inner classes?
Inner classes are possible, yes. And you may have more than one class in the same file. Okay. The other ones, they don't have to be public. They could be private classes for that file. We will talk about that later, actually. Yeah.
But we should have only one main function, main method.
Main method. If you don't have a main, remember in C++, your C++ code test.cpp doesn't have to include a main function, right? If it doesn't include it, then you cannot make it an executable file, right? In your system, if you have many CPP files, one of them should have a main function. Same thing here. If you have many Java files, If one of them doesn't have the main method, then you won't have any executable Java program. But it is still valuable. Why? Because maybe you are working on a library, right? Okay. Good. So this will be clearer when I show you more examples. Another example here. Okay. Another example. Java addition.java. Name of the program is addition.java. And that's why, again, name of the file and the class name is the same, addition class. And line 3, let's look at this one. It is very, very similar to our using in C++. It is very similar to using directives of C++, but it is different. That's the rule. If the name is same as C and C++, they are very, very similar, okay? If the name is different, then they are different. The meaning of class, meaning of public, meaning of static, meaning of integer, meaning of what do you see anything recognizable here? Assignment operator, plus operator, okay. They are all the same. If the name is the same, the meanings are almost the same. If the name is different, then this is different. So in Java, we don't have this keyword using. Instead, we have import, okay. Import is kind of, that means it's like, this is a scanner, is a class, okay, it's a class, it is under this package. In Java, we don't have the namespaces, we have the packages, okay. I am saying that I am going to use this scanner class. It's like using std string, right? It's very similar to that one. So if this was the C++, I would have said, using std vector or using std string. Okay, class addition, again, main question. Why do we have to declare this method main as static? Why is it static? If it wasn't static, to be able to call this main, somebody has to make an object of this addition class, right? And call main. Who is calling the main main method? Who's calling it? Not operating system, but Java virtual machine, right? Java virtual machine, when I say, how am I going to compile this? I will say Java compiler addition.java is going to produce me addition.class, and I will say Java addition. Java is the Java virtual machine, right? That virtual machine say that, okay, I am going to call a main method when I say, okay, let's do this from the beginning then. Java, or use my blue pen, Java compiler addition dot Java. It produced me Java bytecode. Now I am calling Java virtual machine, and I said addition. Java virtual machine says that there must be a file around named addition.class. Yes. It should include a public class whose name is the same as this this name, addition. So there must be a class named addition, and inside that class there must be a static method that I could call. Its name should be main. So Java virtual machine calls addition.main. Okay? Because it's a static method, it calls that static method directly without making any objects. Okay? That's why we call it static. We make static. And it doesn't return anything. It is void. It doesn't return anything because what are we going to return? We are going to return something to the virtual machine. Once this line is done, virtual machine quits and it returns to the operating system. So we don't send those kind of signals to the operating system in Java. That's why we don't return anything from the Java methods. Java main methods. Of course, we return lots of stuff from the Java methods, but we don't return anything from the Java main methods. Okay, good. Okay, any questions? Let me continue. Okay, the first thing that I'm doing is, okay, good. The first thing that I'm going to do is this. It looks like it is too early to use the new operator, right? But no, it is not early, because without the new operator, you can't do much with Java. Okay? To make an object, just hold on to your seat. I am going to tell you something shocking. To make a new object in Java, there is only one way. It is using new operator. Okay? You cannot make an object without using the new operator. It has to be with the new. Okay? It has to be with the new. Remember what I said? This one? This one? This is not possible in Java. Okay? You cannot make objects like this. In C++, it was possible to say string str. This is not possible in Java. No, you can't do that.
We don't have any constructors.
Yes, you have. With the new operator, yes, you have. But you have to use the new operator. Everything has to be in the dynamic memory. And I know what you are thinking. You are thinking that if they, from the beginning, if they are...
Even the basic types?
Everything has to be in the dynamic memory, yes. Just a minute, I will come to that. I know. Okay. Everything has to be in the dynamic memory. And that means that we have to use the pointers, right? To represent stuff. So how do they teach the pointers from the to the 17-year-old kids, right? You are 18 years old? How old are you? You are big boys now. Yeah, okay, good boys and girls, yeah. How do they teach it? They use smart pointers, okay? They have the smart pointers, and they don't have anything else. And this is what we do. This is what we do. Scanner, when I say scanner input, this is not a scanner object. This is a scanner smart pointer. Input is a pointer. It's a smart pointer, okay? So that it knows how to count the objects. It has an object counter in it. And I say that with this pointer, I am going to hold a pointer to this new scanner object.
And okay. Destructors.
What?
Destructors also defined inside.
Well, we will come to that. There are no destructors in Java.
Every object is of the same size?
What?
This
input, yeah.
They're all smart pointers, they're no objects. Everything is the same size.
Right? All the, since it's a pointer, it's the same size, yeah. But of course, this object is not the same size. It is different. Okay, as this is not custom in Java, but since we are C programmers, okay, let's draw the memory. This is usually considered as inappropriate to talk about memory in public in Java, but. Okay, this is my memory. When I say scanner input, okay, this is input. It's a pointer, and this is a local object. This is in stack. Of course, in Java, you don't talk about the stacks. It is considered, again, rude. In public, you don't talk about that kind of stuff. Okay, this is in stack, and this is our new scanner object. Okay, it is very nice that you don't ask about scanners, because it doesn't matter for now. It's an object, right? So you got it. You are good object-oriented programmers. You don't talk about. Okay, good. So this is, I am pointing to this scanner object. Whatever the scanner do, how are you gonna know it? You just look at the documentation, right? I mean, maybe you guessed it. Okay, this is the line 11. Then I have 13, 14, and 15. It is about what Erdoğan Hoca is asking. There are actually two types of things in Java. We don't like it this way, but they designed it this way. For the basic types, like the integers, doubles, characters, okay, they are not considered as objects. They are called basic types. We almost did the same thing. Remember, for the integers, I never wanted to use the name integer as a class. I don't want to use it. We in C++, we said that integer is not a class, but it's a type. In Java, it is the same thing too. These are not considered as objects. These are considered as types. For the basic types, it behaves exactly like C and C++. So when I say integer number one, this is not a reference. This is an object. This is a variable. So I have 1, 2, 3 variables, number 1, number 2, and number 3. No, sum. Okay. So this is the shape of the memory after line number 16. So there is a little bit exception in here, saying that I cannot say everything is objects in Java in memory. This is an object. I cannot name the object, but I can name the reference to that object, and this is the structure. And these are the names of the variables actually. Number one, number two, and sum are the names to the variables, and types of the variables are the integers. Okay, so let's come to line 17. There was an object named out, it's defined for me somewhere, and I am calling this, remember print line? It has a brother, its name is print. The difference print and print line is, after print line, you print a new line character, backslash n. Print doesn't do that, okay? So after it prints this one, it stays on the same line, okay? I say enter first integer to the user, and this is what it does. This is the same as C in number one, line 18, and this is the same. Okay, so this is how you input numbers from the keyboard. This is how they decided to make it work in Java. This is not the only way to input integers or doubles or characters from the keyboard. There are other ways, like there are many ways to input characters from the keyboard in C++, but this is just one of the simple ways of doing it. You make a new scanner object using giving this by, this by the way, this is a stream, okay? It's a stream object. You give the stream, you are saying that this scanner is now connected to the system, the standard input, STD in, okay, standard input. Now, whatever I read, the next integer will come from the keyboard now. Okay, I will make this assignment to this one. This is an integer assignment. Okay, this is an integer assignment. This is a reference assignment. And this is a smart pointer. It keeps count of the references pointed to this scanner object. At the end of this main method, I will not delete anything. There are no delete operators in Java. There is only new, okay? There are no delete operators. You don't delete anything, okay? All the garbage collection is done by the Java virtual machine using the smart pointer ways. Okay, let's continue. I know I am out of time, but I need to finish this one. I don't wanna, because I didn't, okay? And I ask the user to enter me a second integer. I get this one, okay? Let's say so how did this work? Input, next integer. Input is this one. On this object, I am calling next integer method, okay? Of course, what is the return type of this method? Integer, okay? So I assign it to this one. So let's say the user entered 12, and then next integer, the user entered 15, and this operation, addition and assignment operation, two of them. Operator precedence, operator associativity is the same as C, so plus is going to be done before this assignment. Two numbers will get added, the result will be stored in sum, so sum will be 27, and then on the same object again, system.out, I am calling, remember printf? Did you miss it? Yeah, Java has printf, and it was exactly the same as C and C. In C++, we have never used printf. It was exactly the same, okay? It says sum is %d and sum. But this is smarter than the C printf, because instead of providing a sum, an integer here, let's say you provided another object, let's say money object, the compiler says that I cannot compile it. Okay? Remember in C, whatever you provide, it compiles it and it prints some junk. In Java, it is very difficult to get junk on your screen. You have to try it hard. Okay? You have to try it hard. You don't have this problem. Oh, I forgot to send the address of something. Because there is no taking address of something in Java. Okay? So after that, my method ends, and that's it. That's it. Okay? So any questions? Is my... What? Failed to something? Can I compile it now? No, it didn't work. Okay, I will fix it later. It couldn't connect to some place. Okay, any questions? Yes.
Why would we use any other print methods other than printf? Why there is a print line? We can do the same with
Yeah, sure, yeah. I mean, if you don't provide the sum, and if you don't say %d printf and print, not print line, but printf and print is the same, yeah. Well, I mean, overloading, right? Or, I mean, using different ways of doing stuff. I think there was a previous version of that method in Java the libraries, and it was available. Printf was not available at the beginning. They made it available later. To keep backwards compatibility, they made it available too. There are lots of those kind of things in Java. There is one library and another library doing the same thing. What is the difference? They say that this is the newer one. This is a better one. Don't use that one, but use this one. So the short answer to your question is I don't know. It is. Why do we have two different expressions that we use for the same thing in Turkish? Okay, I mean, what do we do? When you say görüşürüz, sometimes you say eyvallah. What is the difference between? I don't know.
The natural languages are not designed. These are design things, so it would be better to have unique things, not these.
Not exactly. We have this term, the concept of overloading. We keep overloading the same function over and over again. It is easy to use for us. The compiler overloaded functions. Compiler is very confused about it. It has to resolve it, right? For the compiler, it is easier to have different names for different functions, but for humans, it is easy to have the same function name for different functions. I guess they are trying to do the same thing, make it easier to humans to remember, use it more convenient way. The answer is I don't know. Okay. Okay. See you in 10 minutes. Yoklamayı imzalamayan var mı ya? Yoklamayı imzalamayan.
Üç slide gitti.
Hocam gönderdim.
Model olarak
programı. Ben de onunla başladım. Ders programı, lisans programı. Hallettim. Size gönderdim. Bakın şöyle bir. Ondan sonra postada yengesin.
Bana gönder.
Yok. Erkan'la sana gönderdim tabii ki.
Tamam, iyi.
Benim başka bir kişiyle kontağım yok.
Tamam. Ben Ayşe Hanım'a sordum ya, bana cevap vermedi.
Seninle kontağı yok çünkü.
Eskiden ama bir dakika yani. Erkan'da yiyeceğimmişim ben orada.
İşte Erkan'a cevap vermiş.
Erkan o da cevap vermiş, başka bir yerden gelmiş.
Tamam, yani sonuç olarak o mu gitti, ona mı cevap verdi? Yoksa daha sonra bizim gönderdiğimiz, senin gönderdiğin yanlış gitti, ona mı cevap geldi bilmiyoruz yani. Çünkü ikisi aynı.
İkisi aynı de.
Doğrusuna cevap vermedikleri kesin.
Doğrusunu yollamadık çünkü sonra. Şuna bakayım da biraz şarj olsun. Niye hocam gelmişler bize? Sen okuluydun. Java'dan vazgeçmemişler. C++'dan vazgeçmiş bunlar.
Ha, özellikle exception'larla ilgileri çok fazla yoktu.
Evet.
Exception. Veya seni dinlemeye geliyorlar, beni dinlemeye gelmiyorlar.
Yo, ben de bir önceki derste de çok
anladım. Veri log ödevi yaptım. Gözünü seveyim. Sonra bir şey yok.
Ne kadar kısa bir şey olarak
ödevlerde
hangi versiyonu kullanacağız ve
ama belli
de olacak.
Yok ya söyledik ya şey 5 S5.
S5.
Eski.
Başka bir şey var. Başka bir şey.
Onu syllabus'ta yazdım herhalde ben.
Oracle kullanacak değil mi?
S5'in ne fark eder ki? Yani şeyden dolayı dedim, bu Oracle yakın zamanda şey yaptı, JDK'yi indirmek için bayağı böyle garip bir kayıt formu falan da oluşturuyorlar mı? Oracle kendisi sana.
Bizim dediğim bir ödevlerle de bir fark yok. Aynen. Bir table buluşuyor. Baştan her şey şey yazıyorsun. Migration. CPU yazıyorsun. Bilgisayar bir şey var bir de. Onların instruction type'ları var. MIPS diye. Onun üzerinden yapıyorsun falan. Sen eksik.
Şey mi yapıyorsun?
Kanka hepsi bir yer alalım mı?
Daha bitiyor bir yer.
Organization diyor ya.
Şey, Verilog'da şey mi yapıyorsunuz? Direkt MIPS Architecture'ın implement mi ediyorsunuz? Biz yapıyoruz. MIPS şey, Architecture'da çalışıyoruz.
Aynen. Şu an ben mesela ilk ödevde CPU yazıyorsun. Data Path var ya. Data Path'te I-Type Instruction'ları için çıkartıyorsunuz. Ondan sonra şey yapacak, şey yaptıracak. Büyük bir ihtimal. Çünkü
R-Type, I-Type, hepsini yaptıracak.
Seni yazacaksınız. Alır mısın sen?
Yapmasan ne kadar kırılır falan. Zaten geç varmış o demek ki. Söyleyeyim mi?
Çarşamba günü Murat'la şey varmaya diyoruz ya. Şey bir arkadaşıyla falan konuşuyoruz. Böyle saygı yetiştiği
bir yok. Evet, bir şey soracağım.
Böyle yaptım sonra devreye geçmeyeceğiz. Ben gaza geldim falan, ben çalışmıyorum.
Fox'u yazmadık ya. Şu an yazdım, koç çalışıyor mu bilmiyorum. Sen işte ben tanıştığından başka bir test yapmayacağım.
Çok kötü ya. Vallahi ben korkuyorum. Ben de mesela şöyle bir şey yapmadım.
Neyse. Yanık
tartışmıyorum. Ama şimdi kendisi yapmadım. Sırt tamdı değil mi? Aynı tekrar yazdım.
Hayır hocam, sadece öğrencilik bir söyleme, başka bir isim söyle.
Yani Nazım'ın geçecek bir var. Yani şeyden...
Coşka.
Hocam biliyorsun bizim milli jüriyemiz rahmetli oldu.
Evet, Coşkun Hoca.
Rahmetli.
Coşkun Hoca gibi bir isim bulamadım.
Evet. Konuşuruz.
Ben teslim etmeden önce göstermeyi hiç tavsiye etmiyorum. Çünkü hemen eksi yüzler falan gelmeye başlıyor.
Okay. So where is the rest of the class?
Onu dere çıkar mıyız hocam?
Sanmıyorum ya.
Saatten sonra çıkamayız.
İki tane de cevap ödevi.
İki cevap ödevi, bir C++'ı dere.
Altı geldi. Altı son CPP. Finallere.
Önce SC'yi aldık herhalde ya. finalleri zaten geç yapıyoruz diyorsun.
Ya finallerden sonra denk gelebilir sonuncusu ya. Biraz zaman verebiliriz yani.
Çok güzel bir şey. Ya zaten geç yapıyorsun.
Bakarız evet.
Çok ama güncel
değil. Evet. Şeyi replerimi güncellemem lazım. Okay, so as I said, line 11, I use this new operator to make a new scanner object. Okay, but at the end of this method, main method, I didn't use a delete operator because delete operator is not in Java. There are no delete operators in Java. Okay, so how does it work? It works this way. When the main method ends, all the local objects are going to be killed. What is my local object in here? Input is a local object, it is killed. Okay. This will be killed and this will be killed. But when this is killed, the object count, the reference count for scanner will drop to zero. When this one drops to zero, Java automatically kills this one. And the number will be killed, number two will be killed, and some will be killed because these are local objects. So when the main method ends, all the objects are gone, including the dynamically created one. Okay, including the dynamically created object. So this is it is very similar to how smart pointers work in C++. In fact, small pointers were introduced to C++ much after Java has introduced them. In mid-1990s. Good. So let's make this comparison actually. If I have a class like in C++ and like Java, what are the differences? If I have a class in C++ like this, Java, I could say this. A is an object of type A, right? Or maybe A is not a good name. Let me make this B, and this one is B2. Okay. B is an object of type A, right, in C++. Here, B is a reference to an object of type A. B is not an object, okay? In Java, you don't give names to objects, okay? You cannot. It is not possible. You give names to only fundamental types, integers, doubles, characters, etc. Or you give names to names to references, which are smart pointers, okay? Which are smart pointers. But in C++, we know that this is an object of type A, but this is an, okay, a pointer to an A. In Java, we don't have this kind of distinction, okay? References are more like this, not like these. Java references are more like pointers, but they are smart pointers. Okay? When I define such a class, remember on the objects of this class, what is available? I can take the address of this object B, right? Address operator is available. Assignment operator is available. I know that it has a constructor, destructor, what else? Copy constructor, right? Destructor, they are all available for this kind of class object. For this kind of a class in Java, there are many things available. There are many things available. And those available things come from the inheritance, actually. Remember what I said before? In Java, all the objects, they all have to derive from this class named object. When you make this class A, okay, class A directly extends. In Java, we don't say derive, we say extend, okay? In Java, all the classes directly extend from this class object. So whatever we have inside this object is available for this class A, okay? So I will have another okay slide on that one, but since I am talking about it, let me show you the Java class object. And this one? Yeah, okay. But I don't like that geek stuff. I need the general Java object. This one? Okay, here it is. Oracle from Oracle. Yeah, that's good. So this is the class object. And for the class object, these are the methods available. Clone is very similar to copy constructor. It makes a clone of your object. And these are, by the way, they are all virtual methods. Okay. So using the reference to the base class, or we call it superclass in Java. Using the base class reference, when you call this clone, it makes a clone of your object. Equals is kind of comparison operator. Finalize is similar to destructors, but since the name is different, it is different from the destructors. Okay. Get class returns some class information. We'll talk about this hash code and equals later. Notify all. Wait. These weights, they are all about synchronization. Java supports multi-threading from the core of the language. It's not a library edition. In C++, we have, especially C++ 11. Remember the thread library edition from STL? So in C++ supports, or C supports, multi-threading, multi-processing using the libraries, but in Java, multi-threading is supported from the core of the language, okay? Because everything has to derive from this object class. So what I am trying to say here is that in Java, whatever is available for this class comes from this object class, okay? It is so natural, so everything is defined inside object, and all the classes that derive from this object, everybody has to derive from there. Would make these available. In C++, it's kind of an exception. You would say that this is an object and these are available and you have to memorize it, right? How do you know that assignment, assignment operator, copy constructor, and the address of operator is available for this object? Because I told you so. In Java, it is not that. In Java, you have to only know that everybody has to come from object. And since object has all those methods available, this one has all the things inherited from this base class or the superclass object. Okay, good. So we will talk about these kind of differences later, but since you know C++ very well, inheritance very well, and references and everything, it is easy to tell you about these stuff from the beginning. So this is very, very unconventional way of teaching you Java, because I am assuming that you are very good C and C++ programmers. Okay, so I am trying to teach you Java in a way that it was done like 20 years ago. People used to know C and C++ very well at the end of 90s, and you teach them Java. That's how we are trying to do it now. Okay, let's move on. Let's try to see what is different between Java and C++. Arithmetic operations, operator precedence arithmetic operations are almost the same as C and C++. Some of the operators are not available, like left shift, right shift. We don't have the bits in there. If statements conditions are exactly the same. We have the Boolean expressions, of course, but we don't use the integers as Booleans, zeros and ones. You either use Booleans or you don't use the Booleans. If you don't use the Booleans, then your if statements will not work. Okay. So in Java, you cannot say if zero or if one. Okay. you definitely have to say, if you, this is what you want to do, you have to say if false. Okay? You can't put a number to places where a Boolean is needed. Other than that, if statements and conditions are exactly the same. Classes, class definitions are very similar to C++. Again, I show you the difference. Again, maybe I should go back and try to make this clearer. You understand why we don't have the semicolon here? Why? Because in Java, you don't declare objects, okay? You create them in heap using the new operator. That's why this would be useless. That's why we don't put semicolon at the end of the class definition. Other than that, class definitions are very similar to C++. Of course, there are differences. See, this is my class definition, beginning of the class definition and at the end. Everything has to be, all the methods have to be implemented inside the class definition. Okay? This should come as a surprise, as a shock. I couldn't wake that guy up, but okay. Act that like this is a surprise. Everything has to be defined inside this class definition, from this curly brace to that curly brace. So in that case, the natural question comes to mind as a C++ programmer is that if everything has to be implemented inside the class definition, how are we gonna ask the question yourself? Everything has to be implemented here. You don't have a header part, or you don't have the implementation part. Yeah, you don't separate them. Everything is the same. You don't separate your implementation into two different files. You don't separate your interface and implementation. Everything is should be at the same place.
It has to be JavaDoc.
Yeah, but I was asking the question, not the answer.
If they know the answer, then they may ask.
No, they don't know. I don't think that they know it. The question is this: if I put everything inside the class definition, including the implementation, how are we gonna hide all that information from the customer? Hiding the details from the customer is important, right? That's why in C++, we had the headers. Inside the headers, we have only the function prototypes and class declarations, right? We say that this is my class, this is the public section, this is the private section, and these are the available to the customer, and I am hiding all the implementation in an implementation file. In Java, you don't have implementation files, you don't have interface files. All you have is Java files, okay? You put all the implementation, everything, all the details in a single file. You don't get to divide them into more than one file. So how does the customer know? How does the customer know how to use your interface? For that case, Java has this solution. Java say that, okay, this is edition Java my program. This is how I compile it. This is how I run it. So where is the documentation? How does the customer know how to use my software? For that one, you have this program named JavaDoc. This is a utility that comes with the Java package, Java documentation. You will say that, produce me the documentation for this program, okay? It produces an HTML file or PDF file, depending on your options, and it makes this documentation file available, okay? Documentation file available to you. So you send your documentation file to the customer. You don't send any headers. You don't send any code to the customer for the documentation. Remember this one, the one that I showed you here. This file, this part is produced by JavaDoc. It says that this class object has this clone, it has equals, and it has finals. How does it know that the definition of clone is creates and returns a copy of this object? Because you provide them that information, okay? Inside, see, this says main method begins execution of Java application. It gets them from the comments. You write your comments, documentation comments, inside your code, at the top of your classes, methods, your data members or the fields, and those sentences are taken by the JavaDoc utility, and they are put into this HTML document or PDF document. So Java has this new way of making this information available for the customer. You don't send anything to the customer that contains code. In C++, we had to do it, right? Sometimes remember the solution that we didn't like about the templates? We had to send the customer our C++ implementation of the whole vector class, right? What was the length of the vector.h? It was a few thousand lines. Yeah, 3,000 lines of code. And the customer get to see everything. We don't like it, but sometimes we had to do it. Java doesn't do it that way. Java says that I am going to send you this documentation file. It contains only the methods, okay, the class names and the class definitions, everything, whatever I put inside my comment sections, specific comment sections, and we will talk about it later. Okay, good. So when I come to classes, when I say class definitions are very similar to C++, of course, there are differences, and these are the type of differences. Inside the class definition, public, private, and protected, the meanings are exactly the same. But for every element, for every member of a class, you have to say it is either public or private or protected. Okay? That's why inside my class, I don't have a public section. Because I have to repeat this public keyword or the private keyword or the protected keyword for all the members of a class. This main is public, then there might be another method which could be private, another method which could be protected, another data member. So you need to repeat this access modifier for every class member, whether it's a field or method. Okay? In Java, yes. If you declare them inside the class, it is not a global anymore. It's a data member or field. I mean, if you make it as static, then it behaves like a global, but it's not a global.
It's like not global, but so we have the methods inside the class. Can we put variables without there being methods?
You mean the data members?
Yeah, the data members.
Sure, yeah. That's object orientation, right?
But do we have to
Yes, sure. Yeah, that's what I said. For all of them, let me show you one example. Since you are asking the question, I have a class named Gradebook. Okay. That Gradebook class has a field named course name. Its type is string and it's a private. Okay. By the way, in Java, you put your privates at the beginning. Okay, well, it's not a necessity. The compiler does an object, but the custom in Java, put your privates at the top. In C++, we try to hide our privates. We usually put our privates at the end of the class definition. Why? Because we are going to send our header to the customer, right? We don't want the customer to concentrate on our privates. We want the customers to see our public functions and public data members first. In Java, you don't send this to your customer. That's why you say that I am going to include this field as a private at the beginning. Okay? And this is my constructor. Okay? Just what kind of assignment is this? Line 11. Name is the parameter. Course name is the field. What kind of assignment is this? It's a pointer assignment, right? It's a reference assignment. So it's not a string assignment, okay? It's a pointer assignment. So what kind of problems do you see with this kind of pointer assignment? Somebody is sending you a pointer and you are assigning, you are making it your, you are referring to that one from within your class. Isn't that problematic? To make a new gradebook object, they send you a string. Well, in Java, you don't send objects. You send references. It's a pointer. They send you a pointer. You make a copy of that pointer, which is a dangerous situation, actually. I mean, you are pointing to somebody else's string, right? So what is the potential problem? If that guy kills their strings, then I will be in trouble. But that guy cannot do that. Why? Because in Java, there is no delete operator. They cannot do that, okay? If they don't keep the pointer, then object reference count will drop by one. I am still keeping a pointer. The problem is his. Okay, there is no problem with the reference count. The problem is this. That guy made an object, send me the reference to that string. And while I am using that string, that guy changed his string, right? Understand the problem? I have a string. Okay, this is the... What is money here? Why? Okay. Oh, no, I'm not going to do this. Okay. Let's say string s new string a, b, c. Okay. And then I have a gradebook object, some code, gradebook g new gradebook and s. I send an s. Okay. So g has this reference to this string abc. I could do whatever I want. The thing is this. If I do s 7a, do you see the problem? I am changing my string. Inside this gradebook, it keeps a pointer to my string. That's a problem, right? That's a problem. So how did they prevent this problem in here? What? There is no deep copy. Well, for deep copying, you need to clone it, but I didn't clone it. I could have said name.clone. It produced me a clone, but I didn't do it. This is a buggy code? No, it is not. It is used this way. The solution is so simple. In Java, string class is not a mutable class. That means all the methods of string class are constant methods. They don't change anything. So that means that this is not possible in Java. You cannot change your string. So as simple as this. So what if I wanted to change my string, you make a new string. Okay? You make a new string while you are copying it. Or there are some mutable string classes, but this is how they do it. So for the new Java programmers, they don't tell these kind of details. They say that you are making this assignment necessarily because they don't understand what's going on actually. And most of the time, this is what I observe. Java programmers, they don't know if they don't know C++, C. They don't know what's going on with the compiler. They don't know what's going on with these kind of problems. I mean, whoever designed the Java programming language, they were very good C and C++ programmers. They knew everything perfectly. And when they make these kind of decisions, it has some purpose on it. So studying Java this way, with this point of view, will make you much better C and C++ programmers. Because you get to think about why did they make this decision? Why they don't have this? What is the corresponding stuff in C and C++? I don't mean that whatever C is doing is better than C, Java, or other programming languages, but trying to find analogies and trying to understand what is going on within that language is a very good educational exercise, and you should do that all the time. But at the end, if you are writing your Java code, use Java programming principles. Don't use C++ programming principles, okay? What is Java is for? It is good for fast development, okay? And don't think about C or C++ while you are writing Java code. Behave like a Java programmer and use whatever they are using, okay? Use their customs. Okay, good. So The question was, it was your question. For the data members, we don't call them data members, we call them fields, okay? Do we repeat this private, public? Yeah, you do that. For every method, for every data member field, you repeat these keywords. I repeat them, okay? So let's go back to classes again. Access modifiers are the same. In Java, we don't call them functions. They are called methods. By the way, methods and fields, these are standard object-oriented programming terminology. All the other object-oriented programming languages use these terms, okay? Methods and fields. Sometimes in object-oriented programming world, we call these fields instance variables, okay? Why do they call them instance variables? Because these fields are repeated for each instance of the class, right? When you make a remember our money class, when I say in, I am writing C++ code, when I say money M1, what do I have inside money? Dollars part and cent part, right? Inside each money object, I have three money objects in here. Inside each instance, I repeat my dollars part and cents part. Each one has them, right? So that's why we call them instance variables. Okay? In contrast to this instance variables, sometimes we keep a single copy for the whole class, which are called static data members. Java calls them class variables. Why? Because for the whole class, there is only one copy of that variable. It's called class variable. So in Java, we call them class variables for the static data members. In Java, we call them fields or instance variables for the regular data members. No global functions, no variables in Java. Whatever you have to do them with objects, with classes. Okay? So how do they handle the math functions, math methods, like sine, cosine, square root? There is a class named math. Okay? There is a math class. Inside the math class, there are static methods, like the sine, cosine, square root, and you call them this way. So this sine or cosine is not global, but they are parts of this class, special class, math. Okay? So it is as simple as the solution. There are no global functions. Okay? Good. Let's continue. Static methods are the same as static member functions. Static fields are the same as static data members. And static members are declared like in C++. You put static keyword. So there is a keyword named static in C++ and Java, and their meanings are almost the same. So we talked about this one. In Java, another shocking statement is coming. Just hold on. In Java, we don't have const keyword. We don't have it. Okay? Similar to const keyword, but it's not that similar. We have the final keyword. Okay, final keyword. To make a constant field name or data member, you use this final keyword, but this function is not same as const. It is a little bit different, especially for parameter passing. In Java, you don't pass your parameters as constant parameters. You don't have that. You don't have that mechanism. Okay? You cannot say that this method will not modify this object. You cannot say that. It is not possible. It used to be very useful for us in C++, but in Java, you don't have it. That means what? That means I cannot do that principle of least privilege thing. I cannot enforce it. But there are other ways of doing it. And Java argues that. I think I agree with it. It is a better solution than the const solution. Okay? Const is too limited to enforce these kind of principle of least privilege principle. Okay? There are more general ways of doing it, and we are gonna see examples. So there are no const keywords in Java, okay? No const parameter passing, no const object returning from methods. And how to deal with it? We are gonna see it later. Okay? yeah, we talked about the static. Main method, of course, has to be static, and we talked about it. Why it has to be, static. Types in Java, you have the primitive types, fundamental types, and the reference types. Unfortunately, they had to make this distinction. I mean, they could have done. Why didn't they make these classes? There is an integer class, and you make all of your integers using NIV operator, right? They could have done it that way, or for long, or float, or double. They could have done it that way. They didn't choose it that way because even Java people, they have to be concerned about some efficiency, right? If you are going to make all of your integers using the NIV operator, that means that you need to, you have an integer and you have a reference to an integer. That means that for every integer, you need to keep 2 times the memory, and you have to always use this reference referencing mechanism, which will be too inefficient. They didn't choose it as well. Instead, they said that, okay, everything is a reference, but we are going to make exceptions. Those will be the primitives. The primitives will be this. We have our booleans, bytes, and characters, and shorts, and etc. For that, these will behave like regular C and C++ variables. But for the objects, there are no object variables. If you have a rational class, when you say rational R, this is not an object. This is a reference to an object. In Java, you cannot give names to objects. No object has a name in Java. Okay? You give names to the references, and you make reference assignments. Okay? When you say scanner SC, this is a reference. This is how you make a new object. Okay? That's the only way. There are a few exceptions, and I will talk about that. That will make sense. For the classes that we will make, NIV is the operator to make the objects of that class. Okay, so references, they are used to point to objects. The default value is null. So null is a Java keyword. Even though they say that they don't have the references, they don't have the pointers. Null is a Java keyword, and it's a null pointer actually. It doesn't point to anything. So when you make a reference like this one, rational R, the default value of this R is null. It doesn't point to anything. Okay? And we use the references to refer to the objects to make method calls. Okay, any questions? I need questions. I don't need a question from you. I need a question. Yes. I will come to later. Do say that again?
Is there any way to create an object in stack memory?
No. The answer is no, definitely no. You cannot make, I mean, if you don't consider these as objects, no. All the object has to be in heap. That's a good question. I don't know why you asked it, but do you know why I asked it? I mean, for C programmers, it comes from the within. Yeah, I just, yeah, that's good. Yeah. Almost the same question, yeah. I mean, the references are local variables. References are local variables, and we keep them in the stack. Since stack is a temporary place, when the method is over, they are all gone. If the references are gone, that means that I need to do some reference count decrement. After that decrement, if the numbers are coming back as zero, then I take them with me. I just kill them. Okay? So can I have references to the references? No. I don't know how to make how to run a new to a new. I don't know. I mean, it's like pointers to a pointers. I don't know. How do they make how do they make two-dimensional arrays? Well, you put two square bracket operators next to each other. There are 2 3-dimensional arrays, of course, but yeah, these are very typical C questions. If you go to some foreign country other than Turkey, when they see how they are doing stuff, Turkish people ask these kind of questions. So, So that means that you are doing that one. So how are you going to do this? I mean, sometimes it sounds funny, but if you are coming from a certain culture, you will think that that's the only thing to do it, but there are other ways of. That's why I always suggest engineers, any scientists or engineers, take like 1 or 2 years, go to some other country, to Germany, England, USA, whatever. Work there for a year or two, okay? Understand how they are doing their things. There are some things that they are doing very good, and there are some things that they are not doing very good, okay? Just to appreciate that what we are doing good in Turkey, you need to see it, right? So when you learn Java, you would appreciate that some of the things in C and C++ are very good, okay? And sometimes you would say that, no, this is a better solution. JavaDoc is a better solution than header files, right? Sometimes you say that. Sometimes you would accept it that way. I mean, you behave... I mean, definitely, I was in Germany 2 days ago, and I had to stop as a pedestrian. I had to stop at the red light as a pedestrian because everybody is stopping it, like 5-year-old kid stopping at the red light. In Gebze, if you stop at the red light as a pedestrian, people would laugh at you, right? They would look at them, what is this guy doing? Why are you waiting for somebody? Right? In Gebze, you don't do that, okay? But in Germany, you have to do it. Otherwise, you cannot live in that country. So trying to observe this kind of stuff from different languages makes you a better Turk or better German, okay? So try to get the best of those worlds. So those kind of questions are very... What was your question? How do they do the two-dimensional array then? That's a very good question. You just stop at the red light, okay? So let me continue. I think I talked about this. Let me continue with the gradebook class. As an object-oriented programmer, let me show you the driver code first. Driver code is in a different file. Remember, this is gradebook, gradebook. File name, public class. There are no mains in it. This is not main, not main, not main. See, there are no mains in this 35 lines of code. But my main will be in a separate file, gradebook test Java. Okay? Just 23 lines of code, gradebook test. My main method, arguments. See, I say, I have a new gradebook reference. It will point to this new object. Okay, another one, another one. So it looks like gradebook class defines this get course name member method. And it returns a string, see? It returns a string. And I print it out. It returns a string, I print it out. This is how I use it. Let me show you how to compile this. I compile gradebook.java. Which does not contain main method. I compile gradebook-test.java, which contains the main method, and I call my Java virtual machine on the gradebook-test.class file. Okay? So, okay, that's good for fingers. How does it find, how does it do the linking? Right, that's your gonna, okay? I mean, how does the compiler, the Java virtual machine knows that this file uses code from the gradebook.java. Well, they are in the same directory, okay, right? They are in the same directory. If you are in the same directory, Java Virtual Machine is smart enough to find those classes and their methods. If your code is in this different directories, then you need to make some adjustment to your Java runtime environment. JRE, you have, remember there was some, yeah, the libpath and the classpath, two environment variables to your operating system. You need to set this classpath so that Java virtual machine can check this environment variable to see where to look for to find the related classes. Okay, so but you are in this, if you are in the same directory, Java Virtual Machine is smart enough to find the code that it needs to execute. Yes?
Can you cover the Java file the jar files.
So what about jar files? You mean for your homeworks?
Yes.
I don't know yet, but I will talk about the jar files later. Yes.
Don't you have an include statement or something?
Include statement?
We
don't have the headers.
So can't we just, import the other?
The other? No, you don't. No, you don't do that. No. It is task of the Java virtual machine to find the bytecode of the other classes. I mean, the default behavior is this. Look for the other class in the same, when I do this, while Java virtual machine executing this one, it says that, this one is making a new gradebook object. Where is the gradebook class? It looks in the same directory. If there is a gradebook.class file, that means that the gradebook is there, right? So by looking at the file name, it knows that which public classes it offers, right? It just goes into that bytecode and it executes its methods.
So before, why did we import the scanner class?
What did we import?
We had a code that imported a scanner class to use.
Because it is not in the same directory as ours. And plus, there is this namespace thing going on. We don't call it namespace, but when you say scanner, which scanner is it? Okay, it is. Remember, when you say scanner, there could be more than one scanner. Which scanner do I mean? I mean this scanner. I mean the scanner of. Okay, Java util scanner. That's the function of it. You don't have to, okay? Because the other file is in the same directory as yours, okay? By doing this, you are not helping the Java virtual machine to find this by compile scanner code. By saying this, you are saying that whenever I say scanner, I mean Java util scanner, okay? Good. And we did the same thing in C++ too. When we say using std string, I am not saying that include std string. I have used another include statement to include the header, right? So this is very similar to the using statement. When I say using std string, I mean, whenever I say string, I mean std string. Okay, so your question is the same as, you could have asked the same question in C++. See, you are asking better questions about C++. While you are studying Java. Okay, so let's go back to our, this is our driver code. Let's go back to the implementation. Simple constructor, simple setter, okay, simple getter. As you see, there are no const keywords for the getter. We don't use the const. Okay, and display message is this. Public void display message. It says system out printf, and I'm going to print this one, get course name. Of course, it could have used the private course name directly, but it says that I am going to use the public interface. Okay, and lots of comment statements, and some of them will be taken to the customer documentation using the Java doc statement. Oh, I am out of time. Any questions? Okay, that's a very good start. I was only covered, for two hours I was only covered 13 slides only, but that was a good introduction. We will be faster. Okay, we will go faster. Next time on Monday, I will continue, I guess. And before coming to class, read the C++ book. Okay, Absolute C++, the whole book, memorize it. Also, watch these videos, today's videos, and read about Java. Read about the history of Java. Read about the discussions, the differences between Java and C++, okay? That way you will be better prepared for Monday's lecture. Okay, see you on Monday.